up the morning to the camera guy. I walk around a lot. Thank you very much. Good afternoon. And what is a futurist? Why is a futurist here? Come on. There we go. Why is a futurist here? Futurism, it used to be kind of the sense of, you know, what's going to be, where do I have my jetpack? When can I get this new, grand new, great new toy? Today, the kind of futurist work that I do, the kind of futurist work that a lot of the people in this profession do now, involves trying to construct context, trying to build a sense of what kinds of implications emerge from choices that we make, and importantly, what kind of surprising implications arise from combinations of choices. So futurism is about trying to get a sense of what's to come. It's trying to build context. And you know, so I'm not going to talk a lot about food per se, but what I'm going to be talking about is something that will help you understand why some of the choices that we'll be dealing with around food and nutrition are so difficult, will help us understand why or what kinds of tools and technologies and ideas will help us, you know, help the world change around its models around food, and will help us truly understand the depth of the challenge that we face. So what will the next 20 years look like? Something like this. Turbulence. This is going to be a very turbulent period. A great deal of chaos, a great deal of disruption. And so I'm going to go over a few of the drivers of turbulence, the kinds of things that will be shaping this era of chaos. Climate. Now, this is not a surprise to any of us. Climate is probably the number one issue that we're going to be wrestling with over the next 20 years and longer. It's going to be the key issue that will shape the politics, economics, will shape our, you know, what kinds of foods are available. We'll be dealing with things around energy. Okay, that's good. We'll be building out new kinds of renewable energy sources. But we'll also, there'll also be turbulence around refugees. What happens to people as they try, as societies, as states, as regions try to adapt and evolve their policies, evolve their politics? There will be a lot of people who will be losing their homes over the next 20 years. But if we want to talk about disruption, we want to talk about turbulence, it's also geoengineering. Geoengineering is this idea that you can do some kind of global scale changes to the climate in order to fight elements of global warming. The most dominant model is something called stratospheric sulfate injection, basically pumping a lot of stuff into the stratosphere to block some sunlight. There's a lot of work being done in research of this, but some of the research is showing that if you do this to try to hold temperatures down, what you'll end up doing is changing rainfall patterns, especially in South Asia. So one element of turbulence is simply the potential for agricultural, crops, crop failures and changes to the agricultural models in South Asia. Resources, depletion and collapse. This is a gas station in the US, but we're not just talking about fuel here. We're talking about issues around water. You've heard a lot about that already, but you're hearing a lot more about that over the course of today and tomorrow. Fisheries. If we're gonna talk about the collapse or the changes to food resources, we have to talk about fish. This is something that many of you probably haven't heard of, but it's something that's going to affect all of us. UG99, it is what's known as a wheat rust. It's the black stem rust. It first emerged in Uganda in 1999, and it has a 100% rate of crop failure. When wheat crops get infected with this rust, 100% failure. And it's been moving out of Africa, across the Middle East, towards India, and there is, as of yet, no cure. There is no version, no strain of wheat that is resistant to it. And it is continuing to move. That's turbulence. Transparency. I took this picture in Los Angeles a few months ago. is at the corner of a major intersection, a WikiLeaks billboard. But I think a better example of transparency is something that happened just earlier today. I was watching over the internet live streaming video of police forces moving in Los Angeles to clear out an Occupy Los Angeles camp. And the fact that people were there with their camera phones streaming live images, live video of this activity is an indicator of just how powerful transparency has become as a political device. Transparency means things like surveillance, you know, governments watching us. It means things like, well, this is a health map, which is basically taking all of this data, aggregating all of this data and making it usable. You take all the data, the research, the findings around health, around nutrition, around food, around climate, and you can put it together in a way that with these kinds of tools of transparency suddenly becomes usable by regular people. And in terms of, if you think in terms of turbulence and the food industry, the emergence of systems that allow you to scan barcodes with your mobile phone and pull up not just information from the producer, but third-party information about what's the environmental sustainability index of this particular product, what's the ethical index of this particular product. Suddenly, individuals, regular people, have access to the kinds of information, the kinds of opinions and ideas that used to only have a fairly narrow audience. Suddenly, everyone can be an activist. Connections. This is actually a map of Facebook connections as of December of last year, so about a year ago. We are increasingly, intensely, intimately connected with each other. And this manifests as local markets. But local doesn't mean what it used to mean. There's no such thing as think globally, act locally anymore. The local is the global. You act locally, you're acting globally. Pandemics, diseases spread in ways that, if you think about the great influenza of the early 20th century, wiping out a significant portion of the European population, that is a dim echo, a dim shadow of what would happen if we had a large-scale pandemic today. Because of how easily people are connected with each other, how easily people travel, the kinds of connections that we have. And of course, things like the nuclear reactor in Japan. I don't know if you saw the news recently that 8% of the Japanese landmass is considered to be now radioactive because of this reactor. These kinds of disruptions may be surprises, but they're going to be critical. They're going to shape what it means to be a citizen of the planet. Economy, so the need for resilience. Now, this is actually an interesting phenomenon. In Africa, there's an increasing use of mobile phones as a mechanism of commerce. So what we're seeing is the emergence of these kinds of experimental methods of building economies, experiments in innovating ways of trade. And the impact of the need for economic resilience is fairly profound. I think there's no need to explain that to the people here, just how damaging economic disruption can be, politically as well. But what it means, and here's an interesting way of thinking about disruption, thinking about resilience, is, in the words of William Gibson, science fiction writer, the street finds its own uses for things. People in communities will endeavor to develop the ways of getting access to energy, access to food, access to work, in whatever way they can, no matter how risky it may appear on the surface. This is, in case it's not clear, that's a power hookup in a favela in Rio. Making things. When you think about disruption, the ability to make things at the push of a button, factories on the desktop, totally transforming the way we do business, the way we, the models of trade, the models of employment. And this is real. For a few thousand dollars, you can essentially feed in a design and print out, literally print out, a physical object that currently is fairly static, but increasingly is taking on the ability to use electronic polymers, solar-powered polymers, and the like. So we're at a point where we're very near being able to build just about anything on the desktop. And people are already using it to build things like drones, remote control planes, entirely printed out. There's the emergence of solar plastic. Energy resources coming not from big centralized sources of power, big centralized installations, but a piece of plastic you slap on your wall or on your roof or on your car. And here's the real fun one: food printers. Devices that take proteins and turn them into meat. The technology was originally developed to build organs for transplant, but it turns out it does a pretty good job of building hamburgers as well. Now, the funny thing is that you think about, we have this concept of meat and the impact that it has environmentally and the impact that it has to our nutritional systems. And you have to recognize that with these kinds of technologies, you're not necessarily tied to those old models. The economic or the environmental impact of food printers is minimal. The cruelty aspect is non-existent. And because you're building from cell by cell, you actually have the ability to change the makeup of what goes into the meat. You want to have omega fatty acids from fish in your steak, it can be done. And then finally, human augmentation. Using technologies to change who we are. This is a drug, a smart drug called Provigil, which basically keeps you awake and makes you think of it faster, and it's widely prescribed around the world. This gentleman here is Oscar Pistorius, a South African sprinter who was born essentially without lower legs. It's a little hard to see there, but he basically has a couple of carbon fiber blades that he uses instead of lower legs and feet. And he is an Olympic caliber sprinter. And I don't mean Paralympics. He came within 2 seconds of qualifying for the South African Olympic team this year. He runs 400 meters in 45 seconds. There's work being done in terms of changing, augmenting our abilities to see, to hear, augmenting our senses. And these kinds of things are not just meant for therapy. They aren't just there to help the people who are disabled. Increasingly these kinds of technologies are available as ways of boosting natural capabilities. We talked about GMO plants, GMO foods earlier today. You have to realize that we're now in approaching the era of the GMO human. Okay, so what does all this mean? You have all these different drivers, all these different elements of turbulence, these forces of turbulence. So let's think about how these all come together. Okay, so the first scenario is one where essentially all of these drivers of turbulence build on each other and make each other worse. Now, in this kind of scenario, we're in a lot of trouble. It's not a disaster for everyone, but it's a world where it's essentially all against all. You can't trust your neighbor because your neighbor is not able to trust you. There's the reinvention scenario where these drivers of turbulence essentially open up new opportunities, opportunities for innovation, opportunities for transformation. A world where you can experiment, try new things, and actually have a chance of building something better than what we have. It's difficult. We have to go through even greater trauma before we get there. But it's a scenario that, if you think about some of the more positive things that I talk about as disruptors, as elements of turbulence, those kinds of tools, those kinds of technologies, those kinds of ideas allow us to build something new. And probably the most dramatic of the different scenarios is one we think of as revolution, where there's no clear direction. It's not something that goes bad, it's not something that gets better, it's that things get profoundly, utterly transformed. It's a future where we can't describe it today because we have no sense of just how utterly different it's going to be. And yet, the kinds of technologies around manufacturing, the kinds of technologies around augmentation, even the kinds of things around food, end up making it a kind of world that is potentially an Eden for some people. It allows us to deal with many of the sustainability and resilience problems, and yet it also has the potential for enormous fear, terror. The ability of people who don't have all of our interests in their minds, in their hearts, taking advantage of these technologies to do horrific things. So what does this all mean? How do we deal with this? There are three strategies that we can embrace. The first is simply foresight. The value of foresight, the value of futures thinking, is that it serves as a vaccination for society. Think about the way the immune system works. The immune system works by becoming sensitized to a pathogen. You get infected with something, the body starts generating antibodies, and so that if you encounter that pathogen again, you're ready. A vaccination jumpstarts that, so it prepares you for something that you might encounter. Foresight, future thinking, is that kind of vaccination. It's a process that allows you to become sensitive to changes that might occur. Become aware of the changes as they're happening so that you can act sooner, act more effectively, act more efficiently, act smarter. Resilience. Resilience is the capacity of a system to tolerate disruption. And right now we have the real focus on sustainability, and that's a very good thing, but sustainability has something of implication of being static. That once you get to a sustainable point, you have to stop and just do whatever you can to stay there. What resilience says, resilience recognizes that the world is constantly changing, that you need a dynamic approach. You need to build on your ability to withstand shock. And so, strategies that focus on resilience are strategies that say, let's be more flexible, let's be more experimental, let's be more willing to accept the occasional setback in order to find the best outcome. Then finally, there's play. Now, you don't often come to a conference like this and hear people talking about play as a strategy. But if you realize that we're in this world of turbulence, we're in this world of disruption, and there's no clear way of dealing with it. In fact, we cannot even understand exactly what's going to happen. Then play, experimentation, innovation, essentially seeing what works, giving it a shot, and if that pathway doesn't work, trying something else. Recognizing that this is as much a social phenomenon as it is an economic phenomenon. Recognizing that it's something that, if you look at it as says something defensive, you end up feeling anxiety at the very least, end up getting really depressed. You end up essentially building for failure as opposed to building for success. If you look at it as play, if you look at it as a way of trying something new, then it gives you that opportunity to reframe, to rethink, to reimagine the world that you're living in. So what do? We can't know what's going to happen. Predicting the future is impossible, but we must act. We have to recognize that we are on the precipice of change. We're on the precipice of transformation, and we are going to leap. The question is, on the basis of our decisions, on the basis of our strategies and choices, are we going to fall or are we going to fly? Thank you very much.